Random House presents Caravan to Tibet by Deepa Agarwal, read by Aishwarya Singh. Acknowledgements. It's hard to know where to begin. So many people have contributed in so many ways to this book. First, I'd like to gratefully acknowledge the late Rosalind Wilson's invaluable input, which played a crucial role in shaping the original Caravan to Tibet when it first appeared as a long short story in the Target annual while she was editor. A big thanks to Deborah Wetter, executive editor of the cricket magazine group, who added her expertise when it was published in Cricket magazine in the same form. When I decided to develop it into a novel, her critical feedback was useful beyond words. To go back further, I'd like to thank my cousin, Wing Commander R.S. Rawat, for supplying the seed idea for this story with his fascinating accounts of his trips to Milam, plus photographs which helped me to visualize the setting, not to mention the various books he lent me from time to time. And even earlier, Pankti Auntie and Joyce Auntie's enthralling narratives of family history served to spark my imagination. Cousin Harish Rawat, grandson of the famous explorer Pandit Kishan Singh, and a well-known mountaineer himself, and his wife, Kaushalya Bhabi, provided extremely important information about Shoka customs, the trade expeditions, and a host of other details. My sister, Prema Rawat Popkin, helped with books that provided useful data, as did the photographs from her treks. Thanks, too, to my cousin Jaya Gupta for her prompt response to a request for information. Several books provided the essential historical facts without which this story could not have been written. Among them are Indian Explorers of the 19th Century by Indra Singh Rawat, Madhya Himalaya Ki Bhotia Janjati, Johar Ke Shoka by Dr. S.S. Pankti, Western Tibet and the Indian Borderland by Charles A. Schering, The Pandits by Derek Waller, Lost World Tibet by Amuri Daryaku, and Kailash Mansarovar by Swami Pranavanand. My husband Dilip supported me during the writing of this book in ways too many to recount. So did my daughters Garima, Sonali, and Geetika, my sounding boards and hand holders. I'd also like to thank my cousin Tripta Sabarwal and her husband Ravi Sabarwal for organizing the trip to Munsiyari, more background, and providing lively company. Thanks too to Heather Dilabre for boosting my morale when I badly needed it. Finally, I'd like to express my appreciation to Sudeshna for her meticulous editing of the manuscript and her excellent suggestions, and to Ajanta for her patience and cooperation. And if in case I've left anyone out, please be kind enough to forgive the lapse. Author's note. Caravan to Tibet is deeply rooted in my own family history, and Debu's journey into Tibet is one that my ancestors actually undertook every year. I grew up in Almora, a small town in Uttarakhand, but knew that my grandfather came from a place much further north where life was quite different from our rather staid middle-class existence. Male cousins who undertook the trek to Milam to learn more about their origins returned with enthralling tales. Girls were considered too delicate to make the trip. They told us about the nomadic lifestyle, the annual trade expeditions, the explorers Pandit Nain Singh and Kishan Singh Rawat, and other members of our extended family who had mapped Tibet disguised as lamas in the 19th century. Some of my aunts and occasionally my father would add to that material. Though our connections with that past had become limited, the colourful rugs or chutkas that Debu tries to sell were part of our household furnishings, along with the silver-lined wooden bowls Sonam Darka uses in the book. And uncles or cousins from the village would visit as well, occasionally making the journey on horseback. All these accounts were so fascinating that when I took up writing as a profession, I just had to put them into a story. Caravan to Tibet first appeared in the children's magazine Target in 1989. Much later, I decided to expand it into an adventure novel, and I'm very happy that it has found a home with Puffin Books. Certain political events led to the end of the trade expeditions in the 1950s, and the Shoka traders have adopted other professions. However, I do hope I have succeeded in providing a glimpse of those exciting times and that my readers enjoy this adventure story. Chapter 1. The Amulet. There was something different in the air today, Debu thought. Something that smelt of good things to come. Maybe he was imagining it, being overhopeful as usual. How often had his father warned him, "Don't expect too much and you won't be disappointed." But Debu had never been able to follow that advice. Perhaps it was the pilgrims crowding the village market who made him anticipate good business. They were passing through the village on their way back from a pilgrimage to the holy Mount Kailash and Lake Mansarovar, the abode of Lord Shiva. Most of the men were obviously from regions further south, with their large eyes and sharp features, so different from Debu's own people, the Shaukas. Did they have enough money left over to spend? "Please, Devi Ma," Debu whispered, praying to the goddess who was his family deity. "Please, make them buy a few rugs. You know how hard up we are right now." "We haven't sold anything yet," his younger brother Hayat said, squatting on the ground next to Debu. Hayat was 10 to Debu's 14 and his chubby face was turning crimson in the July heat. He began to pull off the white woolen coat he wore over his tight-fitting trousers. Though their village Milam, located on the India-Tibet border, stood at a height of over 11,000 feet, the thin air made the sun harsh. It was their summer home. The nomadic Shaukas travelled with their herds, spending winter in the low reaches of Kweti and spring in beautiful Munsiyari. "You should call out to them," Hayat said. Debu's high cheekbones flamed with anger. "I know what to do," he said coldly. "And you'd better not forget who's in charge." Hayat glowered, but his full mouth trembled slightly. Debu suppressed a sigh. He took off his round cap and let the breeze riffle through his thatch of wiry black hair. He was not sure if he enjoyed it, being the man of the house. If only his father would return. Worse, he knew Hayat was right. Just prayers wouldn't do. He had to coax customers to buy their wares. How he hated it, but he had to. These rugs, which his mother had woven, provided a good portion of their income. A pair of enormous leather boots halted before him. A stout man stood there, pointing at a rug. "How much for that chutka, boy?" he asked. "Only 10 rupees, sahib." Debu's smile reduced his narrow eyes to slits. He unrolled the rug swiftly and forced himself to turn salesman. "Feel the wool, sahib. See the brilliant colours." 10? What do you think you're selling? Gold brocade? Not a paisa more than 5. "Remember what Ma said? Get a good price." Hayat had recovered his spirits enough to jab Debu in the ribs. Ignoring him, Debu said, "Sahib, give us 7 at least." The man hesitated. "It's a bargain," Auntie Durga said. The elderly lady who sat next to them had silken soft pashmina shawl stacked before her. "See how skillfully it's woven, as well as any from Persia or Bukhara." "Perhaps you're right," the man laughed. "I'll take it, boy." "Here, sahib." Debu rolled up the rug and counted the silver coins the man handed him. A rush of elation warmed him. He had barely put the cash away when a shadow blocked the sunlight. He glanced up hopefully, then stiffened. It wasn't a customer, but his father's cousin, Trilok. Short, bow-legged, with a straggly moustache and unkempt hair, cousin Trilok had a permanent frown. Even at that early hour, a strong odour of jarn, the local beer, wafted from him.
So, you getting lot of money?" he growled. "When you're planning to return mine?"
"We don't owe you anything," Debu tried to ignore the thumping in his chest. "That matter's been settled by the elders," he gulped. "Uncle Kalyan swore that my father repaid the money he borrowed from you."
"What does that fool know? How can those Dodoran elders settle my concerns?" Trilok snarled. "Tell your mother to return the money fast or she'll be sorry."
"Keep your mouth shut, you drunken idiot," Auntie Durga's sharp voice sliced through the noise.
"Who are you to tell me?"
His bleary eyes glinted.
"Just wait till September, boy, and I'll teach you how to behave."
He lurched away. A red-hot rage roared in Debu's ears.
Don't bother, Auntie Durga said quickly. Half the time the fool's not in his senses. Debu tried to nod and let his breathing even out. But the question continued to throb in his head. How could they get rid of cousin Trilok? Should they pay him off? His mother refused to. Her reply was always the same. Your father cleared that debt. He is just trying to take advantage of his absence. Debu sighed again. The scene of the caravan's return from Tibet last year rose up like an unwanted ghost. The excited cries of the other children. They are back! They are back! The women hurrying towards the path that sloped down to the village, giggling, crooning songs of welcome. And then, the grim faces of the men riding back from the trading trip. Uncle Kalyan Singh, Bijay Singh, Jeevan, and cousin Trilok's sly smirk. He had continued to gaze at the empty path after all the ponies, the load-bearing jabbus and yaks had straggled in, waiting for his father to appear. Something must have delayed him. A load that slipped off, a stone in a horse's shoe. Anything could hold a man up for a few minutes. He kept waiting even when the voices hushed suddenly and the men went into a huddle with the headman, the Bura. The pitying looks didn't register at all. It couldn't be anything to do with them, he thought. Then the Bura summoned him. There's bad news, son. You must bear it like a man. You have to take care of your mother and your younger brother now. The words didn't make sense even when Kalyan Singh, never a man to show much emotion, spoke, repeatedly running a tongue over his cracked lips. It was a terrible storm, son. Just don't know what happened. How Dharm got lost. The snow made it impossible to see. You are a brave boy, I know. He'd squeezed his shoulder and jerked away. It was Jeevan, the youngest of the group, who'd held Debu close when he'd yelled, No, it's not true. He's going to come back. I know it, I know it. Hush, he'd said. Hush. Jeevan's smell had reminded him of Borju's when he returned from Tibet. That mixture of old sweat, leather, horse flesh, overlaid with the tang of the junipers and the scent of herbs growing in the high meadows they passed through before entering the village. And Debu had found it hard to hold back the shameful tears that had flowed and flowed from his eyes. He remembered the date well. 17th September 1891. From the English calendar his father had brought from Calcutta. He had gone there the previous winter to buy goods to trade in Tibet. We need to learn the new ways that the white men have introduced, he had said. We need to keep up with the times. Tell me about your journey, Debu had said. That sounded far more thrilling than the calendar. Tell me about the train, the huge iron horse. Can it really carry hundreds of people? Yes, Borju had smiled. The fire in its belly helps it to run faster than any real horse can. Weren't you scared, Borju? No, his father had said dismissively. Debu knew he rarely was. And now, Debu was sure he was not frightened when the caravan ran into the storm. Which meant that somehow his father must have escaped. But Debu was often afraid. He was afraid that Ma and Hayat might have to go hungry. Afraid that they'd always be poor, and most of all he was afraid that he might end up with cousin Trilok as his stepfather. According to a custom in their tribe, his mother might be asked to remarry their closest male relative, cousin Trilok, if his father didn't return. And time was beginning to run out. In barely 3 months, it would be a year since the caravan returned. If his father wasn't found by then, the Bura would declare him officially dead. No, Debu thought. Borju was definitely alive. Something told him he was. But how could he prove it? If only he could fly to Tibet like the Shokya Lama who had winged his way to this valley in ancient times and settled his people here. That man's looking this way, Hayat nudged him. Rugs, beautiful rugs for sale. Come and buy at unbelievable prices, he called out. The man was so amused at Hayat's antics that he bought their largest rug. And as the day progressed and sales were brisk, Debu's heart lifted. All right, he told Hayat finally. They had sold most of their rugs by now. You are the best salesman here. Come, let's get the wool.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.